Good morning to all our family and friends, and welcome to GCF Northwest Worship Celebration. As we prepare our hearts to worship our Lord, I would like for us to look at the portion of the scriptures in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 29 to 31. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. As the Lord allows us to go through a period of waiting in our lives, may we experience His power continually and grow in faith daily. May we take this time, our waiting upon the Lord, to renew our strength physically and be refreshed spiritually. As we worship the Lord today, do remember that our Lord is the one who gives power to those who are weak and gives grace for all of us to run and not be weary. Let's join our hearts in worshiping the Lord this morning.
Romans 8:31 says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" Good morning, church. May we sing with joy and lift our praises to the Lord. For us, the Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Even when I stumble, even when I fall, even when I turn back, still your love is sure. You will not abandon, you will not forsake. You will cheer me onward with never-ending grace. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Can separate us, hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave His Son to free us holds me in this love. Neither height nor depth can separate us, hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave His Son to free us holds me in His love. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?
How securing it is to be with Christ.
May we clap our hands for him.
We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that sees. Seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that sees. Seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. We bow our hearts. We bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh, give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts, let us not souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God.
Above all names, which we can be saved, is Jesus, our healer, mender, master, and savior. No name is higher than the name of Jesus. Whoa. healer, mender, master, savior, lover, giver, name above all names, ruler, redeemer, risen, conqueror, Jesus, Jesus, name above all names. Above all names, ruler, redeemer, risen, conqueror, Jesus, Jesus, name above all names. Your name is Jesus, risen from the dead. You are the glory, lifter of our hands. Have the only name by which we can be saved. I call you Jesus. Oh, oh. I call you Jesus. Oh, oh. Nobody greater than you. Nobody stronger than you. No name is higher than the name of Jesus. Your name is Jesus, you've risen from the dead. You are the glory, lifter of our head. You have the only name by which we can be saved. I call you Jesus, oh, oh. I call you Jesus, oh. God be all the glory. have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back. No turning.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters in GCF Northwest. May I invite you to bow down our heads, close our eyes, and let's pray. Our dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we are grateful, Lord. We are thankful, Lord, that you have provided another day for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can worship you and praise you, Lord, together, Lord, via online, Lord. And we humbly ask, Lord, your forgiveness, Lord, for your guidance, Lord, and for your wisdom. And whatever circumstances we are in, Lord, whether in business, in health, or in work, Lord, Heavenly Father, help us, Lord, to continue to trust in you, Lord, no matter what the outcome is. And we know, Lord, that we face trials every day. But help us, Lord, to always focus our eyes on you, Lord. Because you are a sovereign God. You control everything. You know all the plans, Lord, for us. The present and the future, Lord. So thank you, Heavenly Father, for this, Lord. Continue to pray, Lord, for Pastor Jerry as we speak your word today. May you touch our hearts, Lord. Open our hearts. Open our minds, Lord, for understanding of your word. And help us, Lord, to keep our mandate, Lord, to always be intentional in making disciples. We thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for the blessings, Lord, that you provided for GCF Northwest. We continue, Lord, for the ongoing renovation, Lord. And we pray for the safety, Lord, of the contractors, Lord, the architects, Lord. Just continue, Lord, to meet and to facilitate everything, Lord. And we pray maging maayos, Lord, ang construction, Lord, at matapos rin sa takdang oras, Lord, na binigay nila sa amin, Lord. And we will always be grateful to you, Lord, for this wonderful gift that you have provided unto us. For this is our second home, Lord. And this will be our meeting place, Lord, again after the pandemic. So thank you, Heavenly Father. We continue to pray for our government. Continue to pray for our president, Lord. And continue to guide him, provide wisdom, Lord, as he navigate us through this tumultuous time, Lord. But Lord, we thank you pa rin na the business is afloat. Everybody has work. And whatever happens, Heavenly Father, Lord, we know, Lord, that you will always be there for us. Again, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, na last week, Lord, we celebrated our anniversary kahit na it's a little, sandali lang kami nag-meet ng face-to-face, Lord, with other brothers and sisters of ours, Lord. And it is a wonderful opportunity, Lord, na nakita-kita ulit kami, Lord. And I pray, Lord, for next year, Lord, tuloy-tuloy na po sa amin. Thank you again, Heavenly Father, for this, for listening to our prayers, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading for today comes from Acts chapter 1, verses 12 to 17, 21 to 26, from the English Standard Version. Let us read together. Acts chapter 1, verses 12 to 17, 21 to 26. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John, and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary the mother of Jesus and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was in all about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So, one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us. One of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection. And they put forward two, Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Acts chapter 1, verses 12 to 17, 21 to 26. May God bless the reading of His Word.
Good morning. Let us prepare our hearts and minds to listen to God's Word through Pastor Jerry Agoncillo. While You Are Waiting, from Acts chapter 1, verses 12 to 26.
Good morning. Who likes waiting? Do you like waiting? Are you patient enough to wait? Someone had said that the problem in waiting is not the waiting per se, but what you are doing while waiting. Do you know the marshmallow test? It is an experiment to measure or to test the ability of children in delayed gratification. If they will not eat their marshmallows immediately and wait for a certain time to be allowed to do so, the children would receive more or a better reward. We know that some children would not wait and immediately eat what they are offered, while others would patiently wait, hoping for a better and bigger reward. Will you take what's given to you immediately, or wait in the future for something that is promised, which is better or bigger? There are three basic ideas when waiting. One, people don't do anything. People's main idea of waiting is doing nothing. However, waiting includes something better and more productive than just simply doing nothing. We must develop stillness and restedness in our souls and bodies while waiting. The second idea is people don't think anything. While waiting, they don't want to think anything. When waiting, people don't do anything and don't think about anything. They would reason out that they don't know the exact time of what they are waiting for. So, they don't think about it anymore. They don't think about anything nor prepare for anything. This is what we call thoughtlessness instead of thoughtfulness. The third idea of waiting is that people can talk about anything. People are free to talk about all things and all about people's lives. They think that waiting gives them permission to talk about anything and everything under the sun. Since they are waiting, they might as well talk about everything and anything about the lives of other people. This is what we call gossip. People tell lies, exaggerated stories, and unwholesome jokes. None of those are God's idea and purpose of waiting. Shall we join our hearts in prayer? Lord God, right now we open our hearts and our minds before you. Would you take away any hindrances, Lord God, from understanding, from us understanding the truth that you have for us today and deposit them in our hearts. Father, may we continue, Lord God, to receive your grace and the truth that comes with it. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you would recall, before Jesus disappeared from the disciples and ascended into heaven, he told them to wait for the Holy Spirit before they would go to proclaim Jesus to all people and become effective witnesses of him to the world. They would be empowered by the Holy Spirit. That's the reason why they have to wait. We can't read in the passage how long they would wait. Jesus did not specify a date or time when exactly the Spirit would come upon the believers. But with careful study, we know that the waiting period was about 10 days. After Jesus was resurrected, he spent 40 more days with them. The period of the Jewish Passover from the day of Pentecost was about 50 days. About 10 days was the waiting period before the coming of the Holy Spirit when the believers in Jerusalem, upon the believers in Jerusalem, as promised by the Father and was repeated by our Lord Jesus Christ. Is there something you are asking and hoping from the Lord? Is there something that you are asking and hoping from the Lord? Is there something God may be telling you to wait upon in your life? Today, I will be presenting to you three specific steps you can do while waiting. Here is the summary lesson I want all of us to consider seriously. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. The first step is to obey God immediately. Obey God immediately. Let me read to you verses 12 up to 13 in our passage. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when he had entered, they went up to the upper room while they were staying. Peter and John, and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. The remaining 11 disciples minus Judas Iscariot returned and went to Jerusalem together with other believers. They obeyed exactly what Jesus told them. From the Mount of Olives or Olivet, they took a Sabbath day's journey. That's about 1.2 kilometers or 3/4 mile. All of them moved to obey what Jesus commanded, to wait upon the Holy Spirit and not to leave Jerusalem. This was different from their reactions when Jesus was arrested and when he died. Instead of following him, they feared for their lives and went back to their previous activities and professions. This time, they trusted Jesus and obeyed what he told them. The question is, why don't people obey God immediately? I can think of at least three enemies of our obedience. One, inaction. Inaction. People do not want to follow God because of lack of faith. They don't fully trust God in what he commanded them. They haven't grown in their knowledge of him. Another reason for inaction is fear. People do not want to obey God because of fear. Fear of making mistakes and missteps. They would rather do nothing than to do something that they are not sure of the outcome or result. The second enemy of our obedience is independence. When people do something or act, they choose to do what they want and wish. They pursue their own desires in their own ways and strength, not what God wants and commands.
The third is indecision. Indecision. Some people can't make up their minds to obey God or not. When people don't obey God immediately, they would fall into indecisions. We will discuss this matter at length later on as one of the reasons why Christians do not obey God immediately. My family and friends, there is no better way to live a joyful and meaningful life than to obey God immediately. Instead of being driven by fear and paralyzed by the lack of faith, obey God immediately. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. The second step that I would like for us to take this morning is devote yourself to prayer and unity with other believers. Devote yourself to prayer and unity with other believers. Let me read to you verse 14 of our passage. All this with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. There are two notable observations we can make on when they obeyed what Jesus told them. One, they were united. They were united. The phrase, all this with one accord. That is what we can read in the passage. All the disciples and other believers together with the women, Mary, and the brothers of Jesus were united. They were of one mind. The phrase one accord describes different musical notes played together to produce harmony or good music. That is where our English word harmony came from. They were in unity and they lived together in harmony. What a sight to see. Believers were united while living together and waiting for the Holy Spirit. The second is that they were devoted in prayer. They were devoted in prayer. While they were waiting, they were not only united, but devoted in prayer. They prayed together. They did not only obey Jesus, they followed the practice of Jesus in praying to the Father and depending upon Him with all their decisions and steps. It's worth noting that Mary, the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ, was mentioned to be together with the disciples and the brothers of Jesus. For your information, this will be the last time that Mary would be mentioned in the whole New Testament. We will not be able to read her name anymore anywhere in the Bible after this. What's amazing also was Jesus' brothers were already believers. Kristiyano na po sila. They were with the disciples obeying their half-biological brother, Jesus. They were in unity and devoted in prayer with all the disciples and believers. One of the brothers of Jesus, James, not one of the 11 disciples, was the first elder or leader of the Jerusalem church and the writer of the book of James in our New Testament Bible. If you would recall, before Jesus died, his brothers were not believers. But after his resurrection, they became believers and followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. My family and friends, I cannot overemphasize our need to be in unity and be devoted to prayer. As one family and church, we should obey what God had told us, to be in harmony with one another and be constantly devoted in prayer to our Heavenly Father. That we depend only on Him for our decisions and plans. I continue to challenge all of you to be united with all our leaders in seeking God's directions and what we need to do while we are waiting for the time, we can already gather and do ministry together in person. Join us every Wednesday at 8 o'clock in the evening for our online prayer meeting. We also have a quarterly praise and prayer time together here in GCF Northwest. And later on, the church would provide more opportunities of growing in our prayer life and dependence to God. While we are waiting, let us develop and strengthen our unity and be devoted in prayer to the Lord. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. The third step for us to take while we are waiting is make decisions based on God's word and wisdom. Make decisions based on God's word and wisdom. Let me read to you verses 15 up to 17 in our passage. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was in all about 120 and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus." Verse 17, "For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in the ministry." Let me explain what happened when the disciples gathered together to pray while waiting for the coming of the Holy Spirit in the upper room. The Apostle Peter stood up with all other 119 believers in the upper room and proposed a decision to be made about the replacement of Judas, who betrayed our Lord Jesus Christ and died. There were a lot of controversies surrounding this passage and event in our in the book of Acts. One is that it's about Peter. Peter who proposed the decision. Was he led by impulse? Did he not wait for the Spirit to come and lead them in their decision? We would not read any command from our Lord Jesus Christ for them to replace Judas. However, Peter was for the first time quoted scripture passages. That was in Psalm 69 verse 25 and also in Psalm 109 verse 8 as the basis of that proposal and decision. It was written and noted by Dr. Luke, who narrated and researched about this account. Yes, he was impulsive, but after the resurrection, probably he had listened intently and learned fully from Jesus' teachings for 40 more days. He understood the scriptures as Jesus taught all the disciples. Two, the controversy is also about the parameters set in the selection. We could not read any instruction from Jesus about the replacement, much more about the parameters of the selection of the replacement of Judas. Here is what Peter mentioned in Acts chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. "So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us. One of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." Those were the parameters that were mentioned by Apostle Peter. But we cannot find these guidelines anywhere in the Bible. Saan galing ito? Galing kay Peter. Naisip po ito ni Pedro. Other preachers call this sanctified common sense, but I refer to it as holy logic. God uses our holy logic or minds to guide us in our decisions. Please listen carefully and look at the context of the situation. Okay, first, the believers were responding on obedience. So that's the first context that I would like for us to look at here. The believers were responding on in obedience to our Lord. Their hearts and intentions were to follow, Jesus or follow God. Second, they were in unity with the believers. They were not doing this for their own interest and concerns. Their desire was to obey the Lord. Third, they were devoted in prayer or devoted to prayer. They were depending on God. They were seeking guidance from Him in prayer. If we have these intentions and attitudes and our heart's desire is to obey God, it's not improbable that the Lord would give us insight and even use our holy logic to come up with specific steps and guidelines in obeying Him further. This may be how Peter came up with these parameters. I still remember in one of our classes with the late Pastor Luis Pantoja Jr., he said, not because something is not written in the Bible, it's already unbiblical. Not because something is not written in the Bible, it's already unbiblical. My family and friends, God can use our holy logic or sanctified common sense to come up with the right and appropriate decisions in a given time. Another controversy surrounding this portion of our passage is that the prayer that was offered to God, let me read to you verses 23 to 25. And they put forward two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. Okay. Verse 24, and they prayed and said, You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in the ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. What was questionable in their prayer? Some preachers and teachers said they limited God in their prayer. God has to choose and reveal which of the two, Justus or Matthias. They only presented two persons they had pre-selected to the Lord. Was this a wrong prayer then? Was it limiting God to choose between the two? Well, the Bible was silent about it. I would not dare to provide a definite answer to all of you. Hindi pa ito kaya ng holy logic ko po. The fourth controversy about this passage is that the process of selection by casting lots. The process of selection was through casting lots. Let's read verse 26. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Casting lots was practiced, and it was not prohibited in the Old Testament. Similarly, when the Israelites want to know God's will, they would go to the high priest whose garment contains precious stones, specifically Urim and Thummim, representing a positive or negative answer from the Lord. Was this process of selection unbiblical and wrong? It was permitted. And in Proverbs 16:33, the lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. Apparently, their practice of casting lot is an expression of dependence to God. But to give you comfort, this was the last time that casting lots were used in the Bible. With the coming of the Holy Spirit and God's Word with us, we have more than enough revelation and wisdom to make right and better decisions that are according to God's will. We would no longer just base our decisions on impressions and emotions, but with clear guidelines and wisdom from God's Word and from the Holy Spirit. The fifth controversy is the person that was picked, Matthias. The person that was picked was Matthias. Many were saying that he was not the rightful apostle and replacement of Judas. If Peter and the disciples would have waited, they would have known that God picked and chosen one was none other than the Apostle Paul. They say that we don't have records of the ministry of Matthias, unlike the Apostle Paul. However, we also don't have records of the other lesser known apostles like the other James, the son of Alphaeus, not belonging to Jesus' inner circle, no? And then Simon the Zealot and Judas, the son of James. Whether Paul's name or Matthias' name will be in one of the 12 apostles, we will know when we get to heaven. My family and friends, while waiting, we practice what is right at the moment. While we are waiting, we participate in the opportunity we are presented with. Let's not fall into the trap of idleness, inaction, independence, and indecision. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. Grow in God and gain wisdom while waiting. For our application, I will not be providing you with more steps because our points are already applications. But I just would like for us to have three reflection questions that will help us gain more wisdom from our lesson this morning. One is that, in what way God is telling you to obey Him? In what way God is telling you to obey Him? Second, in what way are you showing unity and devotion to prayer with other believers? In what way are you showing unity and devotion to prayer with other believers? Third, how are you making important decisions in your life? How are you making important decisions in life? While you are waiting, obey God immediately. Devote yourself to unity and prayer with other believers. Make decisions based on God's word and wisdom. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for challenging us to obey you immediately and for us to always be united and devoted in prayer to you. Father, may this day be a time or a day of not just challenge, but a change among your people. To all of us, Lord God, because you have allowed us to go through periods of waiting in our lives. And even today, may we take this time as a time of growing, a time of renewing our strength by your grace and through the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, may you be glorified in the lives of your people and we can go and be effective witnesses for our Lord Jesus Christ, as the Holy Spirit leads us and empower us every day of our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Again, it's a wonderful day to worship the Lord with you and to look at His Word. I pray that as we continue to go on the journey of a growing church's faith journey through the book of Acts, we would indeed, as one church, together with our family members and friends, join us in this journey and we grow together in God. God bless us all and have a wonderful day.